It's 2018. Take that first step to learn, progress, and grow as a creator and artist. For January exclusively, anyone who signs up with my link below will get 3 months for just 99 cents.
Hey guys, it's Max. Welcome to my comparison between the brand new iMac Pro and my best bang for the buck 4K video editing PC. Now, I made a video on this PC roughly a month ago, and if you guys want to check that out, get all the details, see more comparison tests with Threadripper, with Ryzen, you guys can click this card above, or there'll be a link at the end of the video. You guys can click that card and check it out. But I see a lot of you guys in the comments, especially on my iMac video, saying, well, my Windows PC that only cost me $1,000 or only cost me $1,500 smokes the iMac. So I decided to put it to the test. This computer, I think, is the best bang for the buck. Now, that doesn't mean the cheapest, but it gives you the best performance for the money, even though you may pay a little bit more. Many of you guys know I have a lot of different comparisons, different builds, something in the $600-$700 range, $1,000 range. This system, which cost me roughly $1,350, to give you guys lots of options depending on your budget. Now, of course, the iMac Pro comes in at $5,000. So I do have the base model here. It has an 8-core CPU, 32 gigs of RAM, 1 terabyte SSD, and the Vega 56 graphics card. I'll have a link to this guy in the video description, along with all the parts that are in this system. This system has 32 gigs of RAM, the Intel 8700K overclocked to 5 gigahertz, so we're getting a ton of performance out of it, which you guys will see in just a second. And along with that, I have a cheaper case, cheaper power supply. I just have a 275 gigabyte SSD, which helps get it to that price point. Now, I know the other half of you guys who are not posting that your Windows PC is much better than iMac are gonna come in and say that this is an unfair comparison. This computer is built with workstation parts, and that's completely true. I see both sides of the story, and I actually just got a much higher end computer that I'm gonna be also comparing to this iMac Pro. It has an Intel i9 processor, 10 core, higher end graphics card. So if you guys want to see that video, make sure you guys hit that subscribe button and enable those notifications. I still have a lot of tests to run, but that video will be coming out shortly. So the beauty of building your own computer is that you can buy parts that are not high-end workstation parts. That's going to save you a lot of money, and you can also customize it. So for example, if you don't need 1 terabyte of PCIe SSD or M.2 SSD storage, you don't need to spend the money on it. But to make things more equivalent, if you're going to be getting a nicer case, a nicer power supply, a better water cooling solution, which I have suggestions for all of those parts in the video description. Say you're gonna get a 1 terabyte 960 M.2 NVMe SSD, which is basically on par with what's in there, and you're gonna add in a keyboard, a mouse, a 5K monitor, which there's not very many on the market that would work, you're gonna bring up the price point to roughly $3,500. So you have to consider all those parts and all those accessories that you need, whereas if you're buying the iMac, you get it all in one. Of course, that still has workstation grade parts, which cost more money than that $3,500 setup. It's a lot easier, and you have Apple that's going to service and give you a warranty, which is why a lot of people will spend more money buying an iMac compared to building their own PC. So you really have so much choices on the market. Do you want to buy lower end parts that are going to save money? Do you want to build a PC with higher end parts? Or do you want to buy something that's all made for you, ready to just plug in with one cable and get set up? So that's my perspective on both systems, but this video is taking a look at the best bang for the buck PC versus a $5,000 iMac Pro.
Skillshare is an online learning community for creators with more than 17,000 classes in videography, productivity, photography, and more. It's available on Android and iPhone with the ability to download any course for offline viewing. So stop wasting your time playing Candy Crush and expand your skills with Skillshare. I'm currently watching Mike Vardy's Productivity Habits That Stick on time theming, which I highly recommend. Premium membership begins at around $10 a month for unlimited access to learning, but just for January, you can get 3 months of Skillshare for just 99 cents. This is just for the month of January, so make sure to take advantage of this great offer by using the link in the video description.
So let's start out by looking at some benchmarks. In Geekbench 4, our overclocked PC gets a multi-core score of 28,903 versus 31,159. That is really impressive for a 6-core CPU compared to an 8-core, but we have to keep in mind this computer is running at 5 GHz compared to 3.9 GHz with this CPU once it's under full load. In single core, our PC gets 6,453 versus 5,088 on the iMac Pro. I'm really impressed that the iMac Pro is getting over 5,000. Typically, Xeon processors are really poor in a single core performance. So if you're doing stuff like web browsing, doing simple applications and tasks, they're usually slower than equivalent 4-core or now 6-core i7 computer. Of course, this i7 is getting a ridiculous score of 6,500, which is crazy, but that's because we're running at such a high 5 gigahertz overclock. Geekbench 4 is a decent benchmark, but it looks at a variety of different tasks, not just maxing out your CPU, so that's good for overall performance, but not really great for performance when you're really pushing the system, like if you're doing video editing. For that, we're going to take a look at Cinebench. In our multi-core CPU test, both systems score very closely. This difference is basically negligible, and it's very impressive that the 8700K can score this high. Finally, let's get into video editing. We're going to start off taking a look at H.264 editing, which is what a lot of us use. We're shooting with these consumer cameras, even the higher end ones, and then we're editing and posting stuff on the internet. After that, we're going to take a look at the newer format that some of the cameras are using now, H.265. Then we're going to take a look at RED 4.5K and RED 8K RAW. And lastly, we're going to take a look at Canon Cinema RAW Lite from the brand new C200. Starting off stabilizing a 20-second 4K clip from the A7S II, our PC does this task 15% faster in Premiere Pro and just over 10% faster in DaVinci Resolve. So right off the bat, our PC is starting to take a lead. Now this is because both of these programs prefer a higher clock speed versus more cores when you're doing stabilization. Rendering and exporting a 5-minute 1080p project with 2 LUTs and film grain applied, our PC is 20% faster in Premiere Pro, but in DaVinci Resolve, our iMac is almost 60% faster. Now let's test the same kind of project, but in 4K. Our PC is 15% faster in Premiere Pro, but once again, in DaVinci Resolve, our iMac is 85% faster. Since Premiere Pro doesn't really max out the CPU, our PC build with the higher clock speed is getting faster results, whereas in DaVinci Resolve, it's making better use of that 8-core processor, and we're getting some noticeably faster times. Now let's check out my torture test, which is 4 4K files scaled into a 4K timeline, 2 of those being reversed, each one has 2 LUTs and film grain applied. Our Windows PC is 60% faster in Premiere Pro, but in DaVinci Resolve, the scores are almost the same. So in this test, DaVinci Resolve is basically maxing out both of the processors in these systems, and like we saw in Cinebench R15, the CPU's raw power are almost identical, which results in basically the same time. Now let's take a look at H.265, or HEVC, which is a newer codec that takes up half the space of our standard H.264 that we're used to working with, but it retains the same image quality. I'm going to be using a project similar to the other one, so it's a 5-minute 4K project with H.265 from my Samsung NX1. This has 2 LUTs in film grain applied, and this is just in Premiere Pro because I don't have the studio version of DaVinci Resolve. Rendering to H.264, the PC is slightly faster, but the scores are close, and rendering to H.265 takes almost twice as long. The PC once again is slightly faster. Now with that said, the iMac Pro was a little bit smoother when you're actually editing this H.265. When you grab the playhead and you start dragging it around the timeline quickly to find a certain section, the regular PC starts maxing out its CPU, and you do get quite a bit of choppiness where the iMac Pro is much smoother. Now let's take a look at some RED RAW footage. I'm going to split up Premiere Pro and DaVinci Resolve for these tests because in Premiere Pro, I'm working with timelines that are native to the format. So for the 8K clips, I'm working in an 8K timeline, and for the 4.5K, I'm using a 4.5K timeline, where with DaVinci Resolve, I just have the regular version, meaning I'm stuck with a 4K UHD timeline. Rendering a 5-minute color-corrected 4.5K project to H.264, our Windows PC was 55% faster. Now that is a big speed difference that I was not expecting with RED RAW footage, since it's really efficient, it really maxes out your CPU, so I started to look at our graphics usage, and the iMac Pro is only using roughly 50% of our graphics, whereas the Windows PC with the GTX 1070 was using 90% of the GPU, which is really, really efficient. Now we're testing a similar project, but in 8K, and our Windows PC is 8% faster. In this test, once again, our Windows PC is maxing out the graphics card in the processor, where our iMac is only running the graphics card at roughly 30%, and thus the Windows PC is faster. With that said, the timeline performance was actually better on the iMac Pro, and this is a full 8K timeline, where the iMac Pro at half resolution, so you're viewing 6K, which is really overkill, it's slightly smoother than the Windows PC. The Windows PC does smooth out, but it is basically maxing out the CPU and GPU. There's no really extra performance left, and so at times we do get some dropped frames. Now let's take a look at that red footage, but in DaVinci Resolve, where we're working with 4K UHD timelines. So for the 4.5K, the iMac Pro is actually 45% faster, and for the 8K, the iMac Pro is 55% faster. Just like in our H.264 test, DaVinci Resolve prefers the higher core count of the iMac Pro, and in general, it's using more of the system resources in this iMac Pro, so we're getting faster results. And along with that, the iMac Pro is smoother when you're working with 8K footage with a 1/4 debayer. Both systems can handle it, but just like in Premiere Pro, this Windows PC is getting maxed out, so the CPU and GPU is maxed out, and because of that, every once in a while we get some dropped frames, so the timeline performance isn't perfectly smooth. You can drop it down to 1/8 debayer, but that doesn't really look good. So if you're going to be judging like sharpness or detail, you don't want to be at that setting. So if you're editing red raw footage, the iMac Pro is definitely better in this regard. And to finish off, we're going to take a look at Canon C200 RAW, which is the Cinema RAW Lite. This is 4K 60 frames per second footage, and we're testing this just in DaVinci Resolve because Premiere Pro does not support the Cinema RAW Lite codec just yet. And here we do see some good differences. Our iMac Pro was over twice as fast. And the PC system we have here, the 6-core overclocked to 5 GHz, can't even play back the 4K 60 files, even without any color correction or LUTs or any other effects applied to it. You're getting really stuttery performance, where the iMac Pro with its 8-core processor is able to play it back even if you have like a LUT and some color corrections applied. So in conclusion, what did we really learn from this video? Well, all of you guys out there that are saying my $1,500 Windows PC can smoke the iMac Pro, you're partially right. Especially in Premiere Pro, our Windows PC here that's overclocked, make sure it's overclocked to get all that performance out of it, is faster than a $5,000 iMac Pro. Now, what I have to say is it's not really because of the raw performance. It really is because Premiere Pro isn't making good use of all the graphics and CPU in this 8-core processor. Premiere Pro has really lagged behind like Final Cut and DaVinci Resolve in the efficiency. Thankfully, with the 2018 release, they did crank it up and it did get faster, but it really is not enough. So if you're editing with Premiere Pro, you're definitely better off getting a Windows PC, especially if you're using a system like this best bang for the buck build, which has that 6-core overclocked processor that gets you a great amount of performance for the money, and you can save yourself some cash and get great performance. Now, on the other hand, if you're using DaVinci Resolve, if you're doing heavy color grading or editing in that platform, which can make use of the higher power, then the iMac Pro doesn't seem like too bad of an option. Of course, you are gonna spend more money than building a higher end Windows PC than this guy over here, but you have to factor in that it's workstation grade parts, everything is pre-built for you, you literally plug in the power cable, everything else is wireless and you're good to go, and it's backed by the Apple warranty. For all the guys out there that are making a good amount of money doing video production, video editing, that price difference is really negligible if you're saving a couple grand with a Windows PC versus buying something that's all in one that you set up and you start making money doing video editing or video production. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, please give this video a like. And if you guys want to see more like it, make sure you guys hit that subscribe button and enable those notifications so you guys don't miss out on future videos. If you guys have any questions, you guys can ask in the comment section below. I will do my best to answer those questions. And I have links to this iMac Pro along with all the parts that I used to build this system in the video description as well. Definitely go and check that out. Thank you guys for watching. This has been Max, and I will see you in the next video.